operate. Can I have some guy named Paul Block? This is a security officer in the mall.
Hey, Block? He's one of my guys. Paul, this is Sergeant Howard, the West Orange Police Department. The mall has been taken over and they have hostages. They exit the building immediately.
We don't need any wild cards in this situation.
Copy that. Never been a wild card. Unless you consider the game of Uno wild.
Locked! Can we focus here, please?
Yes, sir. On my way out. Come on, don't die. Don't die.
What?
Don't pee. Don't pee.
Guys, motion detector just went off. Door 26. Everybody on it.
What's he doing? Come on!
Paul, come on!
Come on! Come on! Come on! Come on!
Clark, come on! Come on!
Come on!
Come on!
Come on! Come on! Is he crying?
I can't
leave her. Why? Watch it! Will you talk to him, please? Clark!
Sir, I took a sworn oath to protect this mall and all inside it. I sort of made it my own. It's on the plaque in my room.
Whoa, listen. I think you're making a big mistake.
Trash out the way.
And I'm not going to shoot you, Connie. You're untrained. You're unarmed. Let's face it, son, you present a huge target.
With all due respect, sir, I can't interpret the report from the outside.
Well, Sergeant, looks like you got your eyes on the inside.
Kill me for showing that clip. Let me try to tie it in here. So if you aren't familiar with the movie, the reason he goes back inside is the car that he sees belongs to a woman that works in the mall that he likes, and so he's going back in to save her. And the point of this clip was to show the level of commitment that he has to his job, that even though he's untrained, unarmed, and as his superior said, a large target, he is desiring to go back in, no matter the cost, to save her, to protect the people of the mall. See, Paul Blart, that character, is a man who always felt like a failure. Right? And so this is his one chance to show people that he wasn't a failure, that he would buck the trend of his natural inclinations, and that he would demonstrate wholehearted devotion to his job, and to being more than people thought that he could be. Now, this wholehearted devotion we find in many places. Yesterday, we had a wedding here. You, when you were at your own wedding, when you said, "I do," that was a phrase that was your saying, "I am wholeheartedly committing myself to that other person." Wholehearted devotion is displayed by our law enforcement personnel and our military. You exhibit it in other ways when you go to work, when you respect and honor the wishes of your boss, employer. You are desirous to demonstrating wholehearted devotion. And so as we come to this last message in our series on the election, we want to see how as disciples of Jesus, as the people of God, how we must live with wholehearted devotion to God. And that when we do that, especially during this election season, that we might receive some wonderful benefits that will enable us to not just live through this election season, but actually thrive in it. So, take your Bibles, open your Bible app, whatever you're using, to 2 Chronicles chapter 15. We're going to read all of chapter 15, and we're going to pull from 14 and 16 as well, but 15 being in the middle kind of serves as an anchor and a jumping off point for us. 2 Chronicles 15, beginning in verse 1. The Spirit of God came upon Azariah, son of Oded. He went out to meet Asa and said to him, "Listen to me, Asa, and all Judah and Benjamin. The Lord is with you when you're with him. If you seek him, he'll be found by you. But if you forsake him, he'll forsake you. For a long time, Israel was without the true God, without a priest to teach, and without the law. But in their distress, they turned to the Lord, the God of Israel, and sought him, and he was found by them. In those days, it was not safe to travel about, for all the inhabitants of the lands were in great turmoil. One nation was being crushed by another, and one city by another, because God was troubling them with every kind of distress. But as for you, be strong and do not give up, for your work will be your reward. When Asa heard these words of the prophecy of Azariah, son of Oded the prophet, he took courage. He removed the detestable idols from the whole land of Judah and Benjamin and from the towns he had captured in the hills of Ephraim. He repaired the altar of the Lord that was in front of the portico of the Lord's temple. Then he assembled all Judah and Benjamin and the people from Ephraim, Manasseh, and Simeon who had settled among them, for large numbers had come over to him from Israel when they saw that the Lord his God was with him. They assembled at Jerusalem in the third month of the 15th year of Asa's reign. At that time they sacrificed to the Lord 700 head of cattle and 7,000 sheep and goats from the plunder they had brought back. They entered into a covenant to seek the Lord, the God of their fathers, with all their heart and soul. All who would not seek the Lord, the God of Israel, were to be put to death, whether small or great, man or woman. They took an oath to the Lord with loud acclamation, with shouting, and with trumpets and horns. All Judah rejoiced about the oath, because they had sworn it wholeheartedly. They sought God eagerly, and he was found by them. So the Lord gave them rest on every side. King Asa also deposed his grandmother Micah from her position as queen mother, because she had made a repulsive Asherah pole. Asa cut the pole down, broke it up, and burned it in the Kidron Valley. Although he did not remove the high places from Israel, Asa's heart was fully committed to the Lord all his life. He brought into the temple of God the silver and gold and the articles that he and his father had dedicated. And there was no war until the 35th year of Asa's reign. So for the first time in our series, we're going to talk about a king other than Solomon. And that king is Asa, described here to us in 2 Chronicles 15. Now, to get kind of the setting of Asa and understand a little bit of his background, 1,000 years before Jesus was born, King David ruled over Israel. Israel was a united country. It was a prosperous nation. God had blessed it abundantly. As David died, Solomon, his son, assumed the throne. And we have seen over the last few weeks how God interacted with Solomon, how he blessed him, how good God was to Solomon. He gave him wisdom and discernment. He gave him riches and honor, and he gave him long life. Because of Solomon, and because of God's goodness to Solomon, Israel at the time was the wealthiest nation on earth. It is said in the Bible that gold and silver were as numerous and as plenty as the stones on the ground. That's how wealthy Israel was as a result of God's blessing to Solomon and his people. But we also saw how Solomon had disobeyed God, how he rebelled against God, how he had turned his back on God, how he had not lived faithfully to God in his life. And as a result of that, Israel became a divided nation, with Israel and the 10 tribes in the north, and Judah with Benjamin in the south. And so now you have two distinct nations, two distinct people groups. They each wanted their own king. And so Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, becomes the first king of Judah. And when his term is done, when he passes away, his son Abijah reigns over Judah for 3 years. And then along comes Asa. Asa is the son of Abijah and the grandson of Rehoboam, so the great-grandson of Solomon. And he rules over Judah for 41 years. And if you were to look in 2 Chronicles 14, verse 2, you would find the familiar formula that we find when it comes to all the kings of Israel and Judah. Because it says, King Asa became king of Judah, and he did good and right in God's eyes. We talked about this before, the roller coaster of the good king, bad king formula for Israel and Judah. And here we are on a high with the good king. And Asa, at least at the beginning of his time. And because of Asa's righteousness in God's eyes, because of Asa, God looking at Asa and seeing him as good, God blessed the nation and blessed him. And Asa responded by tearing down altars of foreign gods, by smashing sacred stones, by cutting down Asherah poles, and by going to the people of Judah and saying, look, the way you are living is not right. We need to be people that seek the Lord and obey His commands and decrees. We're told that Asa was fully committed or was wholeheartedly devoted to God. In chapter 14, we see this wholehearted devotion of Asa played out in a real-life situation that took place for him. As he is the king of Judah, the Cushites, a nation around them, came intending to attack them. And the first thing, the only thing that Asa does in defense of his people comes in verse 11 when he prays these words, Lord, there is no one like you to help the powerless against the mighty. Help us, O Lord our God, for we rely on you, and in your name we have come against this vast army. O Lord, you are our God. Do not let man prevail against you. See, Asa understood that God was the best and only option for himself and his people, because he looked at his army and he counted, and he got to 300,000. He didn't really count, but anyway. There were 300,000 in his army, okay? And then he looked at the Cushite army, and we are told that there were thousands upon thousands of them. Some translations word it this way, 1,000,000s. A million. Countless. There were a lot, okay? If you don't get those other terms, a whole lot of them were coming at him, okay? And a whole lot more than what Asa had. He was outmanned. And so he realized, the only thing I can do is rely upon the Lord my God. And so he gets down on his knees and he offers up this prayer to God. And in verse 12, we are told that Asa's devotion was blessed and was answered as the Lord took care of the Cushites. And there wasn't one spear thrown or one arrow shot or any bloodshed from Judah. Now, when we come to chapter 15, we're entering the 35th year of Asa's reign. And we're told that there was a time when Israel rebelled against God. That's not news to us, right? We've read that before. We've heard that before. We're told that there was a time when they were in great distress, when the nations around them were so awful and there was so much chaos that you couldn't even venture out of your own community for fear of being killed or harmed in some way. We're even reminded in the first verses of chapter 15 of God's promise to Solomon. Solomon, if you and my people, if you don't forsake me, I won't forsake you. I'll bless you. I'll provide for you. There will be good for you. And again, we see Asa living this out. That he removed the idols from the land, he repaired the Lord's altar, and then he sacrificed offerings unto the Lord on that altar outside the temple. And then if that wasn't enough, we're told at the end of what we read that he kicked out his grandmother. Okay? Now, that takes a lot of guts to kick out your own flesh and blood, right? To say, hey, Granny, you've been doing wrong. Hit the bricks. That's what he did. He deposed the queen mother because she built an altar or an idol. And he deposed her as queen. He tore down the altar. And in verse 12, we're told that Asa then led the people into a covenant with God in which they would seek the Lord with all their heart. That word used for seek means to take a vow of allegiance to God. Basically saying, I vow to you, God, that I will do what you instruct me and want me to do. And they were to take this so seriously, and they were to live this out, that if you were found to not be doing it, if you were found to not be fulfilling the vow or the covenant, they didn't just smack you on the hand, they didn't just sit you outside the community, they killed you. The death penalty was the result of not fulfilling and not seeking God. and the harsh penalty underscores the seriousness of the event. The binding nature of the covenant and the wholehearted devotion exhibited by Asa and the people in that death was the alternative. But something happened in the 36th year of Asa's reign that changed everything. If you were to continue on reading into chapter 16, you would find that Israel was attacking or trying to attack Judah. Now, to show you just how far the people of God have fallen, not only are they divided, not only do they rebel against God, not only do they have their own separate kings and separate entities, but now they are fighting against each other. Okay? The people of God have been split and now are fighting one another. And so as Israel and their king come against Judah and King Asa, he fears for his life, just like he did with the Cushites earlier. Except this time, he doesn't go to God. This time, he seeks help from a neighboring king, Ben-Hadad, the king of Aram. And he doesn't just go to him and say, "Hey, Benny, I need some help here. Okay, Israel's attacking, I don't have manpower. Can you toss over a few soldiers to help out?" That would have been bad enough. But what he does is he goes to the temple treasury, he takes money, he goes to the palace funds, he takes money, and he goes to Ben-Hadad and he says, "I want to give you this money to buy your allegiance, to buy a treaty with you." Okay, so he's taking God's money, giving it to a foreign, ungodly nation and king, seeking their help. The problem with that was that he forgot the Lord. When the Cushites attacked, he dropped to his knees, offered up a prayer to God, and God answered. But now when Israel attacked him, he doesn't even mention God. He goes right to another human for help. And so the question comes up when we look at Asa's life, where is his wholehearted devotion? What happened to it? Well, we're told in chapter 16, verse 9, that God wondered the same thing because he goes to Asa and he says, "Asa, you've done a very foolish thing. And because you sought the help of a human, because you sought the help of someone else and didn't come to me, Asa, Judah from now on will be at war and there will be no peace." So this idea of wholehearted devotion comes from a Hebrew phrase, Labab Shalem. It means total commitment, full allegiance, a heart completely centered and focused on the Lord. John Piper is a pastor and author, and when he preached on this topic of Asa and this idea of wholehearted devotion, he referred to himself as an example and an illustration of what he was talking about. He said that each week as he prepares his messages, he sits down and he has a conversation with God that goes something like this. "God, I'm seated here at this time with paper and pen and Bible, with quiet, ready to share and to write what the words that you want said on Sunday, that your people need to hear. But," he says, "they can't be my words. They must be your words. Because, God, they don't need to hear from another man. They need to hear from God. And so if you don't speak, I don't speak." And so every week, that's what he goes through. Because he understands he needs to be fully devoted to God. We need to be fully devoted to God. We are doing that when we ask for strength to have a conversation with someone that we've been putting off. We need to do that as we go to work and school and desire to be a witness. "Lord, give me strength. Help people to see you in me. We see that when we're facing a difficult test of some kind. When we're in a valley period, perhaps. And we don't know what to do, so we say, God, I need your guidance, I need your help. Those are ways that we practice wholehearted devotion to God. And at what better time do we need to be people of the Baal Shalem than during a time of election and campaign promises and uncertain candidates? There is no better time for us to practice wholehearted devotion than at this moment, than at this time. Asa ended up trusting in a man he desired the help, the strength, the power of a human, rather than the help and the strength and the power of the superhuman, the supernatural God. And as we think of November 8th, we can get caught up in relying on a candidate or a political platform or an issue. And so we need the Baal Shalem, wholehearted devotion to God. But what I want us to see, what I want us to understand here is that when Asa lived a life of wholehearted devotion, there were some wonderful outcomes, some wonderful gifts that God gave to him and the people. And the first of those is that Asa received peace. In chapter 15, verse 15, it states that the Lord gave him rest on every side. The word rest signifies the blessing of God for a peaceful and prosperous life as a reward for his obedience. God was saying, Asa, you have been totally devoted to me, therefore I'm going to give you peace from all of your enemies. And that's what happened. In verse 19, it says that there was peace and no war for the first 34 years of Asa's reign. In chapter 14, we saw God defeat the Cushites. Judah didn't have to fight. God took care of the situation. They were committed to God, and he gave them peace. Now, what does that look like for us as we face this election in 2016? Well, I don't necessarily think it means that our full devotion to God means that we as a nation will have peace from other countries. It might, but even if we do, that's not my point. You see, our wholehearted devotion to God, I believe, will result in an inner, personal peace and calm. And if we are totally devoted to God, if we have our heart completely centered on Him, then we will know that He is in charge, that He is in control, and it won't matter who wins on November 8th. That we will live in peace, that there will be no anxiety, that there will be no worry, because it's not about us. And it's not about any particular candidate. It's all about Him. In Matthew 11, 28 to 30, Jesus is talking and he says, cast your burdens and cares upon me. Bring them to me. Leave them with me. I can carry them. And in saying that, what he also is saying is, and you can't. He's saying, you're not created to carry that stuff, but I can do it for you. You're not strong enough, but I am. You see, when we bring all that stuff or keep all that stuff on our shoulders, when we continue to focus on our cares and our burdens, we do several things. We worry, we get anxious, and we forget God. And so God says, look, I understand you're going to do all those things, so just give me the stuff to begin with, and your life will be better, and you will know that I am with you. He talks in those verses about us putting on His yoke. We don't talk about yokes a lot unless we're talking about eggs, right? But this is a different kind of yoke, right? It's an old farming implement where they would take two oxen, put them together, yoke them together, attach them to the plow, and they would plow the land. And what they would do is that they would put one older oxen with a younger oxen, so that the older or the younger could learn from the older, and so that the older could do the brunt of the work because the younger wasn't strong enough and ready for that. And so Jesus basically in that verse is saying, I'm the old ox. Come, partner with me. Walk with me. Let's do this together so that you know I am here and I can handle whatever you're facing, and therefore you don't have to worry or be anxious. In Matthew 6, Jesus talks about worrying, and he says, stop it. That's the Stephen, unabridged version. Wait, really, that's what he says. He says, look, don't worry about tomorrow. He said, you got enough going on today. He said, today's got enough problems that you don't need to be worrying about tomorrow. So let's take that out. He says, you got enough problems today. You don't need to be worrying about November 8th. Or actually, a lot of us are probably more worried about November 9th. He says, you don't need to be doing that. Trust in me. Seek me. And I'll be there. And I'll provide what you need. Focus on this day and on the one who is in control of this day. And when we do that, when we live with wholehearted devotion to God, then we get to receive this peace that Paul wrote was beyond our understanding. The second thing that Asa received as a result of this wholehearted devotion was that he was a witness. Look at 15 verse 9. After he had torn down the altars, after he got rid of the idols, after he rebuilt the Lord's temple, we're told that people were attracted to him. Right? That people assembled around him. And not just his own people, right? Not just people of Judah, but we're told that from three Israeli tribes, they had come to Asa. And the reason that they came to Asa is because they saw that the Lord their God was with them. In the way that he acted, in the way that he lived, in his total devotion, they saw God and they were attracted to that. Have you ever stopped to think about the fact that the way we, the people of God, who profess faith in Jesus, the way that we handle this election, the way we talk about it, the way we speak about the candidates, the way we think about the future, that it will greatly impact our ability to be a witness to people who right now don't know Jesus? Have you thought about how the people of our nation desperately need the Lord, and when they see it lived out in a biblical way, they are drawn to it? That's the whole story in Acts 2. Right? Peter has this great sermon. We're told 3,000 people come to Jesus that day. And then we're told that 3,000, they did four things. They learned from the apostles, they fellowshiped together, they ate together, had the Lord's Supper together, and they prayed together. And it goes on and talks about other things, and then there's this one phrase, one line that jumps out at me every time. It says this about the 3,000. They enjoyed the favor of all the people. Not just other believers, but all the people looked at the early Christian church and said, that's a good thing. Now, they may not have all agreed with them, okay? They may have said, you know, I don't really believe the same way, but I tell you what, those are good people. They love people. They'll give you the shirt off their back. They'll do anything for you. That's a good group. If Acts 2 was being written today, that line would not be in there. It would not say that the church today enjoys the favor of all the people, because we don't. Because they see us as not loving, as not giving the shirt off our back, and just wagging our finger at them saying, no, 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 you're bad, you're bad, you're bad. They don't see us a witness. They don't see true biblical Christianity being lived out in us, and they aren't attracted to that. We have a tremendous opportunity to be a witness for Jesus during this election season. That when we live wholly devoted to God, when we live lives that represent true biblical Christianity, man, this thing got really loud, Jim. People are attracted to that. When we live in humility, when we pray for others, when we seek God's face in every area of our life, when we repent of our sin and say, I know better than you, embrace that. When we live in peace, when we are at rest, when we're not anxious about the results of November 8th, people are going to wonder why. They're going to say, how can you be so calm? Don't you see our nation's going down the tubes? And it opens a door for us to share the reason for the hope we have. It enables us to be a witness to the goodness of God. It enables us to be a witness to what being totally devoted to God can do. I close with this quote from Adrian Rogers. He writes, I want to be like those in the catacombs who said, Lord, you alone are God. We have no king but Jesus. That's where the power is. It's not political influence that we need. It is the power of God that we need. Our hope is not in government. Our hope is in Almighty God. Father God, we ask that each day, but especially in this election season, that you would help us to be totally devoted to you. That, Lord, we would place all of our worries and concerns and anxieties at your feet, and trusting that you know what you're doing, that you are in control. And that we just need to rely upon you. So help us as your people to be people of peace, and that in the way that we live, we might be able to be a witness. So that others, through this time, might see you in us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together as we sing a closing song this morning.